tell you what, it's still the anointing that breaks the yoke of bondage and breaks the yoke of sin. When we come into the house of faith and we believe the Lord is able. Second verse of this song, I like what it says. It says, I've been through the fire. Anybody here been through the fire? Anybody going through it right now? Going through some fire right now? Been through the fire. And somebody prayed just this week. I can't give you prayer just this week. Lord, what's happening to me? What's going on in my life? Why am I facing this? Why am I going through this? Why am I having to walk this on this leg of the journey? Look, why? And you know what? It's all right to ask why. But you know, when the Lord gives you a reason, it's time to keep on walking. It's just time to keep on believing. The Bible says that we're going to be the anointed of the Lord. If we're going to be the children of God, if we're going to be used of God, then we're not only going to have to walk through the fire, but we're going to have to be born in the fire and refined by the fire so that the fire can have its impact on our lives. The Bible said we're refined. We're made better than we ever were. We're made pure by the fire. We sing an old song around here once in a while. It's the Holy Ghost and what?
Fire.
And it's keeping me what?
Alive.
Just think the irony in that. The fire, the very thing we think is about to consume us. Man, I tell you, I wish I had it right here, right now. I don't know where the scripture is, but my friends in the sound room can pull it up. That little scripture in there about the Lord is a consuming fire. I want to pull that up for me, Dusty. The very thing that we curse is the very thing that pushes us forward. The very thing we're worried about, the thing that we're all concerned with, bound up by, is the very thing that God wants you to use to initiate conversation and initiate relationship, and the thing He wants to do to burn some things out that don't have any place being in, and He wants to refine us by the fire of His Spirit. What in the world does that say on the screen? Hebrews chapter 12, 29. For our God is a what? Consuming fire. I rest my case. So many people go through life cursing the fire. Cursing the fire. Cursing the fire. Cursing the fire. The very thing that God wants to use to purify us. The very thing that God wants to do to motivate us. The very thing that God wants to do to make us clean and pure and right and holy is the very thing that we often walk around cursing the fire. God uses fire to motivate His people. How many of you have ever touched something hot before in your life? Did it motivate you? Motivate you. Uh-huh. I never heard the old Southern colloquialism. That old boy got gone as soon as I built a fire under him. You know, the Lord must be from the South. Sometimes He got to build a fire underneath us to get us going. Yeah. I mean, y'all stay with me here a minute. Stay with me. A lot of y'all still standing. I'm really, real happy. But I have to see this is working. Okay. It's the Holy Ghost and I, and it's keeping me alive. Keeping me alive. Oh, keeping me alive. It's the Holy Ghost and Jello that's keeping me alive. It's the Holy Ghost and wood and it's keeping me alive. And what it says, it's the fire. And if we lose the fire that's burning in our hearts, in our soul, then I will tell you this, we're an easy target for the enemy. But I'll tell you what, the devil don't mess. mess with most people who are on fire for God. The devil will look at any congregation. He'll go after the weak. He'll go after the easily offended. He'll go after those that just barely struggling along, barely making their way with the herd. You've heard me talk about it before. But I will tell you right now, when you get on fire, you're too hot to handle. You know what? We need to have a desire, Brother Shepherd, that says, I want to be too hot for the enemy to handle. I want to be too hot to handle. I want to be too hot to handle. Brother Cobb, I think we can be too hot to handle. Sister Angie, I think we can be too hot to handle. I think we can be too hot to handle. Amen. Well, Lord, it ain't hard to hit a target that's not moving. Huh? Well, if you're sitting there not moving, it's a you easy target.
Slow down a minute. I'm fixing to work myself out of a job, Brother Slick. Faith is mobile. It's moving. It's speaking. It's shouting. It's dancing. It's worshiping. Faith. And without faith, it's impossible. Impossible. Impossible, impossible, impossible to please God.
Amen. I'm just foolish enough to believe that this song is for me. I was with my kids at the mall last night. If you only knew how much I hate to be at the mall. I already know that hell is going to be a mall. It's going to have no elevators and no escalators. Hell is going to have an infinite number of floors. It's going to have the world's largest food court where all the food's terrible. Hell is going to be one giant parking lot and there's not one parking place. Except way out about 3 miles from the entry. That's going to be hell. I was at hell at the mall last night. With my kids and they had a broke telephone. They took it into the Apple store. They gave them a new phone. The second one. Third one. It's the third phone you got, though. Third Apple. Sorry about that. In 3 weeks. Kids are standing there. Brandon, you ready? You ready to stand and deliver this? Kids are standing there. What a lady turned to you and say, come on. All right. Kids are standing there. They're getting a new phone. You want to sit down for a minute? Go ahead, sit down. Y'all made me so squeak. Okay, kid, you know, they're just minding their own business, getting their third phone in 3 weeks. They're standing there. Little old Rachel's standing there, looked like she swallowed a watermelon. Brandon's standing there looking like Rachel eats all the food. We went shopping last night. Brandon wanted to buy some clothes. Went to Kids R Us. You know, Joe, you know what I'm saying? Got some kid clothes. They do. So they're sitting there at the counter and they had just negotiated their third phone in 3 weeks. So I say my son-in-law is a pretty good negotiator. He's got his new phone. And there's a lady standing there, and I'm not going to go into it. I'm going to let him tell it. But he's had this burning on his heart all week long. And then the Lord sends an affirmation of a complete stranger standing at the phone store along with 250 other people, you know, at the phone store. So I'm going to let him take it from there.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I looked over at this lady and she said, I seen a different look in her eye, and I said, are you from around here? She said, well, she had been in the local area in Louisville for about 4 years now. And I said, there's something different on your face. I can tell you serve God. And she got very excited. She said, yes, I do. I go to a Pentecostal church over in Duncanville. And so we began to talk, and she was very excitable. And she said, I have been called of God as a minister of the gospel. And she said, but Brother Brandon, I want to tell you that I am hungry to see fivefold ministry take place. I am hungry for a new awakening and a shakening in my spirit. I am hungry for something more of God. She began to speak about the things that she read about in the Word of God and the anointing of God that falls. And she called it this, the Shekinah glory. I don't know if you remember or not, but 2 weeks ago I preached a message, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. She then began to speak about Azusa Street Ministry. I don't know if you were here or not when we began to preach about it. And then I don't know if you were here or not last week when God revealed that atmosphere in this place today. Tears of joy began to stream down her face, and she said, I don't know about you, but I'm so hungry for something more. I said, just a minute. We've been talking about it. We've been preaching about it, and we've been experiencing the fivefold ministry, the anointing of the Shekinah glory in this place. You've got to come to church at 805 Sherman Drive in Denton, Texas, where the Spirit of the Lord is alive and well. I said, it's no coincidence I'm sitting here having this discussion with you with such enthusiasm on her face. Do you know that there is a world that is hungry for what you and I experience every weekend and every week out? And we come into the house of the Lord, we should understand that there is a higher anointing that is in this place today. That if you would just humble yourself and reach out to Him and allow God to move in this place, He will let there be an atmosphere that will heal your body, that will save your soul, that will touch your family. Why? Because it's the God that we serve. Hallelujah. Oh, it's not me, it's not you, but it's the presence of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords that is desiring a relationship with you. I'm talking about the people that haven't broke through in this place. Hear me today. You've been in this place for a couple of weeks now, and you've seen, but you haven't had your breakthrough yet. Yeah. I want to tell you what she said.
Yeah.
She said, I started thinking about it. Sister Jessica, I started thinking about it. You have a visitor here today. I hope I'm not scaring you. But there is a power of God that dwells in this place that is so strong. And she said, I was thinking about what month I was in. And she said, it is September. And I started thinking, God began to reveal to me, what is September? It's the ninth month. I don't know if you've ever birthed anything in your life. Has anybody had a child in this place today? Around the ninth month, that child starts to face and go towards its destiny. We are headed towards a destiny in this place today. Hallelujah. This is the ninth month for someone. God is about ready to birth you into a new dimension. He is about ready to birth you into new areas of your life. And she started saying, it is time for new birth in me. I've got to have a new anointing on my life. I don't know what you're facing today, but there is somebody in this place that needs to hear the word from God. This is the ninth month. You cannot stay where you've been before. There's not enough room to continue to live in that womb any longer. But you have got to get ready to face in a direction to be birthed into new levels in your life. Hear the voice of the Lord today. You can't live there anymore. You can't go there anymore. But there is new areas that you're about to be birthed into. Somebody give God praise in this house today.
Yes. Somebody needs to get ready for a new birth. A new birth of joy. A new birth of peace. A new birth of contentment. A new birth of relationship. In the ninth month, the Lord's going to give birth. I'm just asking a little question. How many is ready to be delivered? spiritually ready to be delivered. Spiritually ready to be delivered. Play this song again. Just play it again for me. The one we just sang. Ready? Now the Lord, here's the way the Lord works. He works exactly the opposite of what we think. Just as the Bible says that His ways are not our ways. They're higher than our ways as far as the heavens are above the earth. Now we want to come in here and we want a neatly packaged Jesus. We want Him to do what we want Him to do within our time frame and the length of time that we've decided we're going to commit to Him. But you know, what would it be like if we, now I'm going to scare some people absolutely to death right now. I'm going to shock you. I'm going to scare you. You're going to say, oh Lord, oh, please not that. What if we committed?
Go ahead.
What if we committed that we're going to stay here this afternoon and we're going to worship the Lord, trust the Lord, and we're going to pray until we have an all-out spiritual breakthrough.
Some of y'all right now going, Lord have mercy. Some of y'all ain't never been to a black church before.
That's what they do every service. Ain't no time frame. They don't treat the Lord like a genie in a bottle and take the lid off and rub the lamp and say, Aladdin, come out and bless me right now. I only got about 12 minutes before I got to go eat. Does any members of my congregation know what it's like to sit in church 5-6 hours? Would you look at the hands raised? It's right. Ooh, we got the Lord down to an art, down to a science. Now for about 37 minutes, we're going to sing and worship. And Brother Bradley going to get up here and ask everybody to give. You know, again, hit on that money thing again. Then Tom is going to come in earlier in the week and pre-record the announcements. That's going to take about 2.7 minutes. And then the choir's going to sing or something else. And then Brother Hudson's going to bore us to death for about 35, 40 minutes. And then we have a choice. Either we're going to get right with God or we're going to go back home, you know, messed up.
Come on, Pastor. Come on. Hallelujah.
It's kind of how we got this down. It's kind of stone cold on the program here, okay? What if we had a made-up mind that, okay, Lord, whatever it takes, however long it takes, God, I need to have a breakthrough. I've been on the verge of a breakdown, but I need to have a breakthrough. Lord, I didn't get the way I am in about 2.1 hours, or I didn't get the way I am in an hour and 57 minutes. Lord, it took me years to get this way. You know, it might just take a little time for us to get in alignment with God to make a change.
I got some of y'all scared to death in here. Y'all worried to death that I'm just going to pull that and you're going to have to walk out on me. Because you done got it made up in your mind if Brother Hudson pulls something like that, I'm leaving. Come 4 o'clock, I'm headed to Arby's. Amen? What about just saying, okay, Lord, I'm going to take the limits off.
All right.
Rich, you know that song? Take the limits off. You know anything about it? We're limiting our blessing. Because I will tell you this right now, honey, there ain't none of us can limit our God. I said, none of us can limit God. And I'll tell you right now, if the Lord decides to come and live inside your heart and your life, and He decides to fill you to overflowing, your vessel ain't big enough to hold all that God has. You wonder why people dance and run and shout and worship like they do. It's because when God comes on the inside, you can't hardly contain it on the outside. When you get down to business with God and say, okay, I'm not going to put any time limits on my blessing today. I'm not going to put any time restraints on what God wants to do in my life. And I'm going to take the limits off. Sometimes we are only limited. Our blessing, our healing, our restoration, the joy of the Lord, the strength that God has for us in this congregation is often only limited. Limited by us. Because God has an unlimited supply. An unlimited supply. I don't know how you see the Lord. I don't know what your vision of Him is. I grew up in a church, in an old country church. And you look at somebody as old as me and you say, well, I figured that much. I figured that's where you grew up. Some old country boy. Sister McLean, I remember him singing, Jesus has a table spread where the saints of God are fed. He invites his chosen people, come and dine. With his manna he doth feed. He supplies our every need. Oh, 'tis sweet to sup with Jesus all the time. And then them old timers would just rear back and say, oh, come and dine. The master's calling. Come and dine. You can feast at Jesus' table all the time. He who fed the multitude turned the water into wine. To the hungry calleth now, come and dine. You know what that said to me as a little kid? It said his supply is unlimited. It's unlimited. That his table don't ever close down. And there's never a shortage of anything you need that you can come on up in here anytime. It's a big table. There's a lot to partake of on it. And all you gotta do is just come. All you gotta do is just get up. All you gotta do is just rise up and receive what God has prepared for us. Rachel, if you know that song, and you can sing any of it, I want you to sing it for His glory.
No boundaries I see increase all around me. So stretch forth and break forth, God, release me.
Yes.
Enlarge my territories with no limits and no boundaries.
Tell me.
I see increase all around me. So stretch forth, break forth, God, please release me. Enlarge my
yes.
Release me, Lord.
whatsoever we ask with faith believing. Goes on to tell us, ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened up to you. Do you want a greater ministry? Now's the time to seek the Lord. Do you want a greater voice in the kingdom? Now's the time to say yes to God. Do you want to fulfill the promises that God's made to you in the past, but they've been on hold for a season? Now is the time for the Lord to increase your territory. I said, now's the time. Now's the time. Now's the time. That's it. Come on, would you join this couple right down front that's decided today is the day of salvation. Today is the day. Now is the time. This is the hour. Save that which is lost. For somebody, you have the gift of God. You have the gift of His Spirit, but you've lost an area of your ministry. I said, you have the gift of God. You've been born again of the water and the Spirit, but your ministry is deficient. Your ministry has been stepped on by other people. You've been lied about and talked about. You've been mistreated, but I'm here to tell you right now, the Lord will never lead you wrong, and He is not a liar. The Bible said that He is not a man that He should lie. I tell you right now, God's not sorry He ever called you. I say God is never sorry that He ever called you. God is never sorry that He ever called you. I said He's never sorry. So it needs to hear me. He's never sorry that He ever called you. He done that, my God. Hallelujah. You just need to trust the Lord's hand in your life. Trust the power of God's ability to turn the situation around. I want you to understand. So you say, well, I don't know if I didn't have this one against me or that one against me. If I didn't have this one, I'm going to tell you what, the people of God have always had their enemies, and they always will. That is the arch nemesis of our life, that Satan himself is our greatest adversary. But he's got many who would be the enemies of God and the enemies of the people of God. Let me tell you a little something. I'm not going to let one enemy in my flesh command the potential of my spirit. I said I'm not going to let one enemy in my flesh command the power and the potential of my spirit in Jesus. We need to rise up at once and seize the blessing that God says is ours and the promises that we have been given. There are prophets and apostles that have spoken into our lives and told us many things, and some have yet to see those things come to pass. But I'm telling you, not many days hence, those things shall be born in you, because this is the ninth month of the year and it is the month of birth. And new things are about to be birthed. New areas of ministry, new avenues of blessing, new joy, new provision is coming your way in this birth month of the year. I'm here to tell you right now, we need to push in the spirit and allow that thing which God has so ordained to be born in us, in Jesus' name. I stood with my wife, and she had two children. The labor of giving birth for both of our two children was the most intense right at the end of the labor process. Somebody needs to hear what the pastor's saying. I said, the pain, the suffering of the labor was the most difficult, the most intense with natural childbirth. At the very end, the apex, right before that child is delivered. Often it requires the strongest push for that infant to be born and for that joy to be fulfilled in our lives. Sometimes the greatest push comes right at the end. So I want to tell somebody here today, you feel like backing up, and some have felt like giving up. Some have felt like you'll never be used of God and you ought to throw in the towel on your personal ministry or in the power of your witness or whatever God has given you a word for in the past. But I'm here to tell you, you're right where God wants you to be, and the hardest push is right at the end. It might be painful for a moment, but all of that will be eclipsed when that which is in you is born of the water and of the Spirit, and God starts to use it, and it starts to walk and talk and to breathe and take dominion, power, and authority by the Spirit. That which God gives birth to in you starts to live and breathe and have its being, and it came from you by His Spirit. You're in the time of testing, the crucible. In the final moments, don't give up. You need to reassure somebody standing next to you and say, hey man, don't give up. It's going to be all right, brother. It's going to be all right, Larry. Don't give up. Don't give up. It's going to be all right, brother. Don't give up. Don't give up. I'm going to go a little step further, brother Freeman. I'm not going to let you give up. If it's within my power to encourage you and to help you, I won't let you give up. You tell somebody, I'm not going to let you give up. I'm here for you. I'm going to stand with you. I'm going to stand by you. I'm going to make that phone call. I'm going to make that text. I'm going to put that email together. and I'm going to get a hold of you. If I think that your foot is slipping, if you think my foot is slipping, don't you love me enough? Don't let me fall. Come on, don't let me slide. Don't let me slip back into an old way of life. Come on, love me enough to fight for me. Love me enough to allow something to be given birth to in our lives that we can see the fruit of our labor. Every service we come to, God is aligning people to receive their miracle. Now, this is a whole different season that we're in. Sometimes we come together, Mr. Jerry, and we preach a message. And I love all the messages that are preached here. I hadn't got to preach just here of late. I want to. But I will tell you what, I've been praying. I've been praying now, Lord, for moments that are life-changing, life-altering moments in people's lives. And you know what? We've heard thousands. Any of us that have been in church 10, 15, 20 years, we've heard not hundreds of messages. We may have heard it, yea, but thousands of messages. It's hard to respond to every message that you hear simultaneously, but I will tell you this, God's already sent the call out. Now he's sending in the hungry. Brandon said just a minute ago, a lady just turns to him in a store and just starts ministering and says, I'm hungry. This is the ninth month of the year. This is my birth month. This is the time that something's going to be birthed in the church. This is something going to be birthed in our ministry. This is the ninth month. People are hungry. People are starving. We got to lead them in the right direction. We got to minister to them. We got to have the power ourselves to minister to others. Now here's what I want to ask before we go.
Has God ever given anyone in here a word that is yet to come to pass? Anybody? A word that's yet to come to pass? Just raise your hand up high, please. A word, because this is going to give other people confidence. Would you lift your hand up high? Have you given you a word that's yet to come to pass? All right.
We are not alone in our struggle. We're not alone. We're not alone. God's given many people in here a word that is yet to come to pass. But I'll tell you this. We don't receive anything that we are not prepared to receive. We don't receive anything we're not prepared to receive. So we get prepared to receive it. When we welcome it. The Bible says the Lord is returning after people that are longing and awaiting for his appearing. So, and those that have made themselves ready. Did you hear what I just said? They have made themselves ready for this blessing. Because they would be having put on a garment that would be without spot, wrinkle, blemish, or any such thing. They have anticipated his return. Anticipated that glory. Anticipated the bride of Christ to return. Or for us to return and the bride of Christ to go to be in heaven with him. So there's that anticipation. So our homework this week is to anticipate the answer to your word.
God gives us all a word. Sometimes we think about it. Sometimes we fail to think about it. Sometimes we get bitter about it. Now, I'm not going to dare ask everybody to raise your hand that's bitter about the word you've been given and it hadn't transpired yet. Some have been given a word that was 15, 15, 20 years ago. What you must understand is God lives in the infinite expanse of eternity. Time means nothing to him. Job said, our life is but a few days, Brother Gary, full of trouble. It's just a vapor. Here for a moment and vanisheth away. Just a few years, we here, we pass in the sea. The Lord deals in the infinite number of infinity and eternity. Time doesn't mean much. Time means everything to us, and it means nothing to God. Brother Carney, if I was to give you 100 pounds of gold today, would that be a blessing to you? Would it? 100 pounds of gold. I don't know what that'd be worth, but it's worth a lot. But to the Lord, it's just payment. Now everybody in here going to go home tonight and pray that the Lord puts a pavement on it. It's just a little pavement. It don't mean nothing to God. He paves the streets with it. We can just think like the Lord for a moment.
But I will tell you this. If it was promised, I don't care if it was a year ago, a month ago, or 20 years ago, if you'll hold on to your promise, If you'll just have faith, I believe that we'll receive the inevitable outcome of our promise the more faith we have to receive it. Right? I'm going to paint you a little picture. Y'all ready? Somebody comes up to me and says, I'm going to give you a blizzard. That's going to make me really happy. I'm going to give you a blizzard, a Dairy Queen Reese's Pieces blizzard. Jay, that's going to make me so happy if somebody comes up and says that. Do you know what, Brother John? I go from here, go back and forth to my house for 37 years and never get my blizzard. One day when you decide to get in your car and drive out there to Dairy Queen and sit in the parking lot and call the person that reminded you and tell them, hey, you said you was going to give me a blizzard? Well, guess what? I'm sitting out here in the parking lot of the Dairy Queen. How about now? Now, are you more often going to make that a possibility if you're sitting at the Dairy Queen or if you're sitting up at your house? Marvin, I think just putting some feet to our faith is all it amounts to. Just coming into alignment, Brad, with what God has for us. We got to go after some things. You know, the time for passive church is over. The time for just letting the devil beat on us until we're just almost dead and then crawl down to an altar, barely battered and bleeding, and say, Lord, restore me. I've been beat down for 100 years. No, I think it's time to get a backbone like a saw log and say, come beat on me, devil, because greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And God had given us a name that's above every name, that at the name of Jesus all hell trembles. I'm not waiting for the devil to come beat on me or beat my ministry down or beat my family down or beat my relationship down. I'm going to take the fight to him, and I'm going to take the fight out into the trenches and the places where the people need God. I'm not going to sit on my bed of ease because the Bible says, woe be unto them that are at ease in Zion. We need to take the battle because the battle is the Lord's. I will receive my ministry. I will fulfill my calling. I will do what God has promised to me. You need to recite the things that God has promised you and be praying over them so that you can receive them. Don't forget them. Don't be bitter about them, and don't let it go. God has it in his hand. He wants to give it to you. Would you stand all over the building? I can't tell you what's happening in our services. I just know the Lord is in it. I'm going to tell you, God wants us to be proactive in the Spirit. I say God wants us to be proactive in the Spirit. I told you last week, coming into this atmosphere, anticipating a move of God, anticipating the righteousness of God, anticipating the fulfillment of the Lord's Spirit. Come into this atmosphere, into this place with anticipation. We struggle for the first 35, 40 minutes of service today because people are just like a mule looking at a new gate. What's going to happen now? What's going to happen now? You know what's going to happen now? Nothing's going to happen unless we get up, unless we get mobile, unless we begin to praise him. We begin to worship him. We begin to proclaim him. We begin to recite our promises and believe on the Lord. Nothing's going to happen. I said, nothing's going to happen. Nothing's going to happen. We're going to sit idly by. We're going to see the blessings of the Lord go right by us. So here's what we want to do. When we come into this atmosphere, we need to anticipate the glory of God. Anticipate the move of God. Anticipate somebody receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost and being baptized in Jesus' name. We need to visualize it by faith. We need to see it by faith. We need to take that vision one step further. And we need to say, okay, Lord, on Thursday, on Friday, and Saturday, prepare me to invite somebody to come into the atmosphere of faith and receive a promise from God. Prepare me, Lord. Let me use that car you've given me. Let me use that driver's license that I have. Let me use that ability to bring somebody to the foot of the cross in the house of God. Lord, let me bring somebody to you. And let's start anticipating the glory of God. How many of us ever anticipated something bad to happen? And guess what it did? Anybody? Oh, bunch of liars. Three people raise their hand. I anticipate something bad every day. I'm just gonna take the mask off and show you I just face something bad happening every day. I gotta work on me. My flesh is weak. I said, I gotta work on me. Some of y'all think I'm Superman. No, I'm just a man. How many of y'all, when something bad happens, it's always run to the worst thing? Air conditioner stops blowing on the car.
I knew it. Compressor's probably out. That'd be $1,300. Only to look down, I just have the fan on, not the compressor. Push another button, blows ice cold. Thank you, Jesus. Isn't it funny how we get a blessing, instant blessing? But we can preach a whole message on being negative about it. Anticipate the glory. Anticipate the power. Anticipate receiving your word from God this month. And let me tell you something. This month ain't very much longer. So we'll be here a couple of more weeks. How would you like to receive that word that God gave you 5, 10, 15, 20 years ago? Receive it this month.
Anybody here would like to receive it this month? I'd like to receive it during the birth month. I'd like to have it. I'd like to receive it. I'd see the things God's promised me this month. Now, here's what I want you to do. I don't want you to get weary coming to church during the season when the Lord is working and moving. There may be preaching. There may not be preaching. There may be some exhortation like we've had today. There may be singing. There may be just a prayer meeting. But I want to tell you what God is doing. He's developing. He's shaping. He's building the church. He's strengthening us. He's undergirding us with the type of strength that's going to take to go into the highways and hedges and compel people to come in. Don't get weary. Don't get all bummed out because it didn't go just like you thought it would, because I'm here to tell you God's ways are not our ways. And He's going to move in ways that we never imagined possible. We need to anticipate that and get ready for it. Amen. Just anticipate. I want you to know I love you. I believe everybody in this church loves each other. There's no fussing going on here. No, none of that crazy stuff that might be going on in other places. We don't have it. I want to tell you right now, I'm proud to pastor this church. If you're a visitor and a guest here, you'll come into an atmosphere of love, power, and a place that people will care for you and love you like we love our own family, because once you came here, you become our family. You become our family. Stick around long enough and you'll find out why they call it Calvary Church, a place for new beginnings, because this is a wonderful place. I love you and I thank you for being here. Would you bow your heads with us today, Lord? We stand in your presence. Lord, we have set it no limits, no boundaries. I feel the increase, Lord, everywhere, all around me. Stretch forth, Lord, break forth, release me, enlarge my territory, God. I pray that you would anoint and bless everyone under the sound of our voice. Strengthen the heavy-hearted. Bless those, Lord Jesus, that are going through something. Give them the strength to traverse right straight on through it to the blessing on the other side. God, I pray that you would anoint this church. The words that have been given us through pastors or prophets, pastors, teachers, evangelists, I pray right now that those words would come to fruition and we would receive our promise in the ninth month. We would have it before the end of 2 weeks. I'm going to pray specifically by the authority of Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.